Hello, everybody. I'm an alcoholic, and my name is Eddie Vaga. And we would like to welcome anybody here for the first AA meeting, visiting from out of town, coming back here for the first time at the Bottom Line. Would you please introduce yourself, not to embarrass you, just to get to know you.
Hi, my name's Mary. I'm an alcoholic member.
Hi, Mary.
Welcome. Anybody else? Okay. Alcoholics Anonymous is a fellowship of men and women who share their experience, strength, and hope with each other that they may solve their common problem and help others to recover from alcoholism. The only requirement is a desire to stop drinking. There are no dues or fees for AA membership. We are self-supporting through our own contribution. AA is not allied with any sect, denomination, politics, organization, or institution. It does not wish to engage in any controversy, neither endorses nor opposes any causes. Our primary purpose is to stay sober and help other alcoholics to achieve sobriety. I ask someone to read more about alcoholism.
Most of us have been unwilling to admit we were alcoholics. No person likes to think he is bodily and mentally different from his fellows. Therefore, it's not surprising that our drinking careers have been characterized by countless vain attempts to prove that we can drink like other people. The idea that somehow, someday, he will control and enjoy his drinking is the great obsession of every abnormal drinker. This persistence, the persistence of this illusion is astonishing. Many pursue it to the gates of insanity or death. We learned that we had to fully concede our innermost self that we were alcoholics. This is the first step in recovery. The delusion that we are like other people, or presently maybe, has to be smashed. We alcoholics are men and women who have lost the ability to control our drinking. We know that no real alcoholic ever recovers control. All of us thought at times that we were regaining control, but such intervals, usually brief, were inevitably followed by still less control, which led in time to pitiful and incomprehensible demoralization. We're convinced to a man that alcoholics of our type are in a grip of a progressive illness. Over any considerable period, we get worse, never better. We are like men who have lost their legs. They never grow new ones. Neither does there appear to be any kind of treatment which will make alcoholics of our kind like other men. We have tried every imaginable remedy. In some instances, there has been brief recovery, followed always by a still worse relapse. Physicians who are familiar with alcoholism agree there is no such thing as making a normal drinker out of an alcoholic. Science, one may day accomplish this, but it hasn't done so yet.
The 12 traditions. I'm Jim One, our common welfare should come first. Personal recovery depends upon AA unity. Two, for our group purpose, there is but one ultimate authority, a loving God, as he may express himself in our group's conscience. Our leaders are but trusted servants they do not govern. Three, the only requirement for AA membership is a desire to stop drinking. Four, each group should be autonomous except in matters affecting the other groups or AA as a whole. Five, each group has but one primary purpose, to carry its message to the alcoholic who still suffers. Six, an AA group ought never endorse, finance, or lend the AA name to any related facility or outside enterprise, lest problems of money, property, and prestige divert us from our primary purpose. Seven, every AA group ought to be fully self-supporting, declining outside contributions. Eight, Alcoholics Anonymous should remain forever non-professional, but our service centers may employ special workers. Nine, AA, as such, ought never be organized. We may serve boards or committees directly responsible to those they serve. 10, Alcoholics Anonymous has no opinion on outside issues. Hence, the AA name ought never be drawn into public controversy. 11, our public relations policy is based on attraction rather than promotion. We need always maintain personal anonymity at the level of press, radio, and films. And 12, anonymity is the spiritual foundation of all of our traditions, ever reminding us to place principles before personalities.
And we are passing the basket in accordance to our seventh tradition, which states every AA group ought to be self-supporting, declining outside contributions. And I ask someone to read the secretary's report.
Alcoholic Bob.
Hey, Bob.
Hey, Bob.
So Bottom Line Group Secretary's Report. Welcome to the Bottom Line Group, especially newcomers. The most important person in the room. If you'd like to become a member of this group, put your name in a light book up in the corner of the desk. It means you can vote on important issues concerning this group at the next business meeting, which is held on the first Sunday of every month at 6:45 p.m. Sorry about that. Anniversaries are held the last Sunday of the month at 7. If you're celebrating New Year, most of you are up to write your name on the whiteboard over here, along with number of years, so we'll have a medallion for you and cake, and somebody said the best to you for an hour. Books are for Santa Claus, campus are free. If you need a black book, pay to be a chairperson. Service is important. You get involved by being a greeter, making coffee now, cleaning up after the meeting, or coming to the weekly cleaning held every Sunday at 1 p.m. Is there anyone willing to be a temporary sponsor? Please raise your hand and keep it up. Okay, well, temporary sobriety, get temporary sponsors. There's also a list of temporary sponsors back on the board over here. The Bottom Line Group asks that you do not congregate in front of the building. We have a lovely area in the back of the building to congregate. We also ask you to refrain from parking in the front parking spaces during regular business hours, approximately 7:30 a.m. to 6 p.m. Any announcements for the good of AA?
It's good.
There's one up here. It says, carry the message day, Saturday, 6 p.m. at Nova Southeastern. Potluck dinner, bring cover dish, side dish, or dessert if you can. Free event. Let's carpool out there. Meet here at 5 p.m. If you have a car, show up. If you don't have a car, show up. Hopefully, we'll get a ride. Fun Food Fellowship. Who can ask for more?
When is that, Eddie?
See you all Saturday at 5 p.m.
This Saturday?
Saturday, yeah, it would be this Saturday. They didn't put a date. Okay. They just put Saturday.
Yeah, it's this Saturday.
Oh, this Saturday. Okay.
It is.
Thank you. Right. Any more announcements? No? Okay. Does anyone need to share anything that may cause them to drink today? Cool. All right. This is a closed big book topic discussion. And what I've been doing over the last few weeks is I pick a paragraph or two out of the big book. I'll share some of my experience with it, and then we'll open the floor up to others' experience. What I do is I ask Mike to read it for us, and then after he's done, I'll kind of go over it through my experience.
Mike, I'm
on. Am I?
Mike. This is on page 25. It's just one paragraph. Back. The great fact is just this and nothing less, that we have had deep and effective spiritual experiences which have revolutionized our whole attitude toward life, toward our fellows, and toward God's universe. The central fact of our lives today is the absolute certainty that our Creator has entered into our hearts and lives in a way which is indeed miraculous. He has commenced to accomplish those things for us which we could never do by ourselves. Yeah.
Hello everybody, I'm an alcoholic and my name is Eddie Vaga.
Hi, Eddie.
And I want to thank God, sponsorship, and the 12 Steps of Alcoholics Anonymous for saving my life and allowing me to be a free man. And again, having had an experience with this book, as I sat with my sponsor, he allowed me to have my own experience through this book. The one thing he always showed me was that this book states facts. It has promises, it has warnings, it has directions, but it also has facts in it. And in this, just one paragraph alone, they state two facts, not just one, but two. So I needed to pay attention to this one paragraph. And it's telling me about an experience that I'm about to have if I follow the clear-cut directions in the book. And it says, the great fact is just this, and nothing less. Just this and nothing less. That we have had a deep and effective spiritual experience. I have had a deep and effective spiritual experience. Which has revolutionized my attitude, my whole attitude towards life, towards our fellows, and towards God's universe. I don't hate the world. I came in here hating the world, hating you, and hating everything that was going on. And I stayed in Alcoholics Anonymous for a couple of years, and I still hated you, I hated the world, and I hated God. I could not form this relationship with God, and because I could not form this relationship because I didn't have a deep and effective spiritual experience, I was still living on self. And because I was living on self, no wonder the world still agitated me. So I would come to meetings and complain about everything in the world and never about fixing me. Because I hadn't had a deep and effective spiritual experience. I had a meeting experience, which meant I made a lot of meetings, and I experienced what meetings had to offer. But the next fact tells me what takes place when I have a deep and effective spiritual experience. And it says, the central fact of our lives today is the absolute certainty that our Creator has entered into our hearts, not into our minds. There's a big difference for me from God living in my mind and living in my heart. And when He starts to live in my heart, is when I have had a deep and effective spiritual experience. If I'm still living from my mind, I hadn't had that experience that they're talking about, that deep and effective spiritual experience. And our lives, in a way which is indeed miraculous. I didn't come in here looking for this. All I wanted to do was just stop drinking. And thank God that I just didn't settle for not drinking. Because for me, Alcoholics Anonymous is not just about putting down the drink. That is the first thing I do before I get here. It is about living a sober life. It is about living from a place that is totally different from the way I walked in through that door. Because if I just walk through that door and put the drink down, I'm still left with the same Eddie that walked through that door. And eventually, it catches up with me over and over and over. And I'm wondering, how come I relapse so many times? Nothing had been done about the problem. He has commenced to accomplish those things for us, which we could never do by ourselves. That's a powerful statement, powerful paragraph in this book. It is what they're talking about is going to take place in my life if I do the work that's required of me in Alcoholics Anonymous. And that means the triangle. It does not mean the fellowship. I cannot stay sober on just recovery. I cannot just stay sober on fellowship. And I cannot just stay sober on unity. In order to feel this deep and effective spiritual experience that they're talking about here, I had to get involved on all three sides of the triangle. I tried just one side of the triangle, the service. Then I tried just the recovery. And then I tried the unity. And every time I fell short, because I cannot become whole until I do all three sides of the triangle. And then my attitude towards you, towards the universe, and towards God starts to change. And now, and again, I mean, we're in a situation right now where we're having a tough time. It's not going to take away from me being of service to this God that I have plugged into. I still must suit up and show up. I must still show up for the day and for those that He presents me with. Because that's what I aligned myself to do when I got here. And I started to do this work. To be of maximum service to God and my fellows, it says. It doesn't say to be of maximum service to God and alcoholics only. It says to my fellows. That means that I will be presented throughout the day with other people that may be seeking help, and I need to be open to see that. And the only way I had that to be able to see those things is when I have an effective, deep and effective spiritual experience. Now, not everybody here has to have that. That's the great thing about Alcoholics Anonymous. You know, not everybody has to do this. Not everybody has to do the book. It's not, you know, it's nice because when you do it, you get to have some different, you have a different perception of life. And the thing is that I found myself from going from being here for 2 years and relapsing multiple times to getting solid in front of my foundation when I started to do this. The other thing that I always have to remember is that my God lives in my heart. He does not live in my mind. I'm the one that loses my mind. No wonder it's so destructive. It is my God that lives in my heart, and when I start to again live from my heart, my perception of things becomes different. So now, when I was living in a halfway house, I'm not saying, man, I'm living in a halfway house. Instead, I'm saying, thank God that He got me a place to stay. I start to see the shift start to happen. When I don't have a job, I gotta be grateful that there's food in the fridge still, and that there's a few dollars in the bank, and that I'm gonna be able to walk through this. I don't get caught up in these places where, oh man, what am I gonna do? How am I gonna do it? Shift. There's a shift that takes place in Alcoholics Anonymous when I get to work. I don't know about anybody else. I can't speak for anybody. I know the shift took place in my life. And because it's taking place in my life, I get to now see things for what they are, even though I want them to be different. And there's days I can do it, and there's days I don't. I'm going to tell you that I do it every time. But I've gotten a little bit better at dealing with situations than I used to. I don't run to a drink or a drug anymore. That's out of the question. Now it's about life. And I think, again, the book later on says, this is a design for living. It's not a design to just stop drinking. It's a design for living that works under all conditions. That was very important to me. But I can't live based on my own ideas. That's why prayer and meditation are important. And all the things that get me back to a place where I have to take a deep breath and say, okay, what do I do next? And how do I do it? Give me the strength and the guidance. Because that's why it has deep and effective spiritual experience. So I can be guided by something greater than myself. And that's my experience with it. So we'll open the floor.
I'm an alcoholic. My name and my problem is Angelo. You know, it's been my experience that there's really no absolutes. You know, when I deal with a human being, it's just like a doctor. You know, a doctor, you go in there, you got a malady, and a doctor prescribes whatever. Another guy walks in with the same malady. It's always the same medication. The only trouble is, everybody's metabolism is different. I found that everybody's psyche is different also. We talk about serving God and going through a psychic change. I did have a psychic change, but that was psychic. It wasn't something, because a lot of times I hear people share in the rooms, and I think I'm in Winchester Cathedral or St. Patrick's. And it wasn't meant to be like that. It's my perception and my psychic change that makes a difference. And if I believe, the higher power I believe in, and I agree with you, the God that I'm aware of lives in my heart. You know, it even, you know, if you want to get into a Bible thing, it says, we'll not worship idols. I see people worshiping idols everywhere. And that's not my idea of a psychic change. I got to treat my metabolism for what it is. I got to circumvent these problems that I manufacture and that I live with. I have to change all my perception mentally, this committee we talk about that lives in our head, or my head, exactly. I know a guy in Davie, he's got 36 years in the program, and he'll tell you right in the meeting, I got 36 years and never did a step. Now, when you get 36 years, you tell me your experience and what happened. Yeah, you better that one. You know, and so it proves that however you go about this thing, we are suggestive only. My perception of that book might be entirely different from Tommy's, of different phraseologies in it. But I believe that if I go along with that book as I perceive it, it helps me greatly, and it teaches me the scheme of living. The drinking part is out, the drugs are out, and all that devious thinking is gone, because of that psychic change that slowly evolved. Now, I can't pinpoint exactly what did it. I'm not going to say one individual influenced me to stop drinking and stop thinking that way and stop acting like that.
It was a gradual change, psychic change. And the more it happened, the better life got for me. And I thought, hey, there's something to this. But to pinpoint and say, this is what did it, and pinpoint it and say, this is what did it right here, or that picture on the wall did it, or this page did it. No, for me, strictly for me. And thank God there's so many opinions in here we can draw from. Take a little what you need, leave the rest. That's what I do. I get something out of every meeting, good or bad. Some people I want to emulate, some people I wouldn't want to be caught dead with. But, I mean, that's my thing. And it's worked for me so far. I mean, you know, it's just like I preach this all the time about looking at myself in the mirror and saying I love me. As goofy as somebody might think that sounds, and it sounded goofy to me. And I do it twice a day, and I've been doing it for 23 and a half years. So if it worked for me, it might not work for you. I don't know. You might look in the mirror and want to vomit. Who knows? But it worked for me, and I want to continue to do so. I think I'll hang around a while. It's really a unique outfit.